This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Welcome to A Conversation with History. I'm Harry Kreisler of the Institute of International Studies. Our guest today is Philip Bobbitt, who is the Herbert Wexler Professor of Federal Jurisprudence and Director of the Center for National Security Law at Columbia University. His new book is The Garments of Court and Palace, Machiavelli and the World That He Made. Philip, welcome back to Berkeley.
Nice to be here.
Tell us a little about Machiavelli. When was he born? When did he die? And what positions did he hold in his society?
Machiavelli was born in 1469 in Florence. He came from an old family, but not an aristocratic family. His father had been trained as a lawyer, but was barred from legal practice for pre-existing debt to the city of Florence. At a relatively young age, in 1498, he was brought into the signoria, into this kind of secretariat of governance in Florence, in a position that I would analogize to something like a director of the National Security Council, or perhaps an undersecretary of state. He was there for 14 years. The Republic was crushed. The Medici, who had been thrown out by a revolt in 1494, returned, and Machiavelli was imprisoned, he was tortured, and expelled in 1512. Exiled to a farm, he began writing, and with some forays back into government, increasingly as he got older, he became a notable playwright, of course, a very important political philosopher for his posterity, and finally died in 1527, just after the Spanish attack on Rome.
You list in your work his many positions, in addition to the ones you just mentioned. He was an administrative bureaucrat, a drafter of statutes and at least two constitutions, along with being a historian and a playwright. So a real all-around person who was familiar with different positions, but also was very erudite in a way and learned in classical texts.
Yes, he was. He was inspired throughout his life by the Roman Republic. We don't think that he read Greek, but he read Latin easily. He had the contemporary languages of Europe. He was quite a successful diplomat, representing Florence not only in the other cities in Italy, but with foreign courts, the Holy Roman Emperor, the King of France, King of Spain, were all people with whom Machiavelli negotiated. But yes, he did have this role as a man of letters, quite an extraordinary literary figure. People say, I'm not fit to judge, that his play Mandragola is the finest Italian play of the Renaissance.
So as you undertook this commentary on Machiavelli, you're entering a hornet's nest, because he's somebody who in addition to his many works across fields, is also somebody that scholars have been commenting on, analyzing, and differing in their opinions on him. So the question that I want to ask you is sort of, what is the responsibility of a commentator entering this landscape and how you came to undertake this work.
Well, I think there are layers of responsibility, but the first duty of the commentator is to try and determine what Machiavelli himself thought he was saying. That's not easy. This is a very different culture, a man with a different sensibility. These works were written half a millennium ago. But that's the first duty. And then second, to see what it means for us today, to imagine ourselves with the moral and political conflicts that Machiavelli confronted, and see whether they have some relevance to us. And I think they do. I think that the point that you make, which is that there's such disagreement about what Machiavelli really thought among scholars, is perhaps the paradox of Machiavelli, that someone could be really the most important political philosopher since Aristotle, and we still can't agree on what he had in mind.
For you, it's very important, and a choice you make in the beginning when you undertake this, is to look at the body of his work, which you see as relating to the state. So you don't just look at the prints, but you also examine the discourses on Livy. Talk
right.
a little about that, because that
That's
because
right.
The commentary seems to focus primarily, not your commentary, but that of others, on the prints.
That's right. Well, the Republic falls in everything but name in 1512, and as I say, Machiavelli is, after being imprisoned, is exiled to his family farm just near Percosina. In an amnesty when the Medici Pope Leo X is invested in Rome. And he begins writing a book that is a defense of republics through an examination of the Roman Republic, which is its model. Livy, the great historian of the Roman Republic, is the principal figure in this analysis. And these chapters are later gathered together in a book called The Discourses on the First 10 Books of Livy, of Livy's history. The Discourses, we know them as. In the midst of this, he stops. He breaks off his writing about this much longer work on republics and starts writing a book on principalities. He sees the chance, now that you have a Medici Pope and his brother, a Medici ruler in Florence, that the papal states, only nominally controlled by the Pope, in the heart of Italy, could be united with the contiguous possessions of Florence and its region to form a state right in the center of Italy, a state capable of fending off these invasions by France and Spain and Germany. What we usually focus on is just that book on principalities. In fact, what we usually focus on is just a few chapters in that book, which talk about the duty of princes in creating and sustaining principalities. It's a very common thing for people to say that the prince is a mirror book, that it is a book of advice towards a ruler, and it is slightly that. But it's well to recall that Machiavelli himself never referred to the book as the prince. He always called it the principality. And in that book, the one we know as the prince, that he called the principality, he refers to his book on republics. And so I think if you really want to understand his thought, you need to read his book on principality side by side with his book on republics. If you read it that way, you'll see that what we have as his legacy is really one great book on the state. And he says at the beginning of The Prince, all states are either republics or principalities.
And we should note that it was his publisher, you point out, who changed the title 2 years after his death.
Posthumously, exactly.
Yeah. So, and I'm curious, and I have here, and you can, I've marked the place, you can read it. Explain to us how you came up with the title of your book. I think it's toward the bottom of the page where...
It's taken from what is probably the most famous letter of the Renaissance. Machiavelli is on his farm, and he receives a letter from Francesco Vittori, one of his closest friends, who is a diplomat in Rome. Vittori describes his typical week in Rome, and it is rather opulent and licentious and full of pomp and circumstance. Machiavelli writes back to him, and he says, I'm living on my farm, and since my latest disasters, I have not spent a total of 20 days in Florence. I get up in the morning with the sun and go into one of my woods that I'm having cut down. I spend a couple of hours inspecting the work. I go to a spring, to one of the places where I hang my lime traps for thrushes. Then I make my way along the road towards the inn. I chat with passers-by. I ask about news. I observe mankind. By then it's time to eat. With my household, I eat what food this poor farm and my modest patrimony yield. When I finished eating, I return to the inn, where there usually are the innkeeper, a butcher, a miller, and a couple of kiln workers. I chat with them for the rest of the day, playing games. And these games lead to a thousand squabbles and endless vituperations. When evening comes, I return home and enter my study. On the threshold, I take off my workday clothes covered with mud and dirt and put on the garments of court and palace. Now clothed appropriately, I step inside the venerable courts of the ancients, where graciously received by them, I nourish myself on that food that alone is mine and for which I was born, where I am unashamed to converse with them and to question them about the ends they sought by their actions, and they, out of their kindness, answer me. And for 4 hours at a time, I feel no boredom. I forget all my troubles. I do not dread poverty. And I'm not terrified by death. I absorb myself into them completely. And because Dante says that no one understands anything unless he retains what he's understood, I have jotted down what I have profited from in their conversations and composed a short study on principalities.
And hence your title, The Garments of Court and Palace. Now, in looking at Machiavelli to write this commentary, you come with a background as a constitutional scholar, a strategist, and a historian in a way. So you, especially in your book, The Shield of Achilles, have really mastered these three areas.
I'm afraid that's not true, Harry. You're kind to say that.
Mastered is the wrong word. You've actually worked in these three fields. Okay. So hence your desire to put together these two works. Now, one of the criticisms that I've seen made of this work is that you overemphasize, you come down too strongly in favor of Machiavelli's constitutionalism. Yes. And his republican instincts. Talk a little about that before we actually get into it, what Yes. you're saying about Machiavelli.
One of the most neglected parts of the corpus of Machiavelli's work are two constitutions that he wrote for Florence, for one for Leo X, one for Clement VII, two Medici popes at different times. They reveal three things. There are many things, but three important things that immediately come to mind. One is his devotion to republicanism, because in both of these constitutions, he describes a tripartite system of representative government with checks and balances and representation from different classes balancing the interest of the people in Florence. And he is preparing these constitutions for the Medici. And that shows a second thing. That shows a good deal of courage. because he says, you cannot go back and rule. You cannot create a principality out of Florence. It must be a republic. In both of them, he says, in the first one, your generation can stay, but the next generation has to give way. Then in the second constitution, some years later, he says, perhaps the second generation can stay, but it has to go. It has to become a republic. And that in itself is important for us because we tend to forget that Machiavelli was not an advocate of principalities. He was an advocate of princes as the founders of states. But he believed strongly in not just the public interest, but in and not just the public weal, but in the superiority of self-government by the people. This was his lifelong commitment, for which he took many personal risks and had many setbacks. And this has sort of been buried in our understanding and in our neglect of these constitutions.
So for you, as a student, I will say, of history, strategy, and law, you think it's very important to combine an understanding of his diplomatic experience, the constitutional context as evidenced by the constitution he's written, and then the strategic events of his time. That's where you're coming from.
That's right. That's right. I don't think you can sever Machiavelli's thought and take it in an ideal way from the political conflicts he was struggling with. Many people are puzzled by the last chapter in The Prince, chapter 26, which calls upon a rather incompetent Medici ruler to protect Italy, to become its savior, and to repel these great states, Spain, France, and the empire that have invaded Italy, to be its redeemer and savior. It seems so out of touch in tone and in its specific program with the rest of the book. But when you put Machiavelli's life and his written work inside the context of the diplomatic and political struggles he confronted as a professional diplomat, you see this isn't something it's tacked on. It is, in fact, the driving purpose of the book itself.
Does working with his materials and his life convince you that a kind of a real understanding of transition between worlds requires a complex body of experience? So do you come down saying only a theorist can prophesize the future, or do you think you really have to have the experience of being in government, of working with other nations as a diplomat of some sort, and then the classical education and history?
I won't say there's only one way, but it's certainly true that Machiavelli profited greatly by his experience. He says in his books, other political philosophers have described an ideal world, a world that has never existed, and they urge us to seek this world. It will never exist. He said, I write about the world as it is and how we can take the instruments we have and the world we must make and reform it. That sounds to me like a practitioner. That doesn't sound like someone who is writing on a blank chalkboard. So I think that is an immensely important for Machiavelli. Having said that, he's not mired in his own time. In fact, the great misunderstanding of Machiavelli, I think, is one shared both by his enemies and his friends, who thought that feudalism was there forever, and who took his ideas about the future, that feudalism would collapse, and that states would arise, modern neoclassical states that mimicked the states he admired of Rome and the Greek city-states, that vision of his is ignored, and by ignoring it, they subjected him to the kind of criticism that would be more appropriate if he were writing about feudal realms and not about modern states. Still, you only have one chance to make a first impression, and that misimpression about Machiavelli is with us still, with the word Machiavellian that captures this devious sycophant, this murderous prince.
So what do you think is the role of ideas in bringing about kind of a new structure, a new organization of international life?
You know, I think that has to have an organic role. If they are summoned entirely independently of our experience, like spirits, then I think they have rather little chance of surviving the realities that political life is composed of. On the other hand, it takes a very rare spirit to be familiar enough with the demands of political and diplomatic life and still raise her sights or his sights high enough to glimpse what the future might hold.
In The Shield of Achilles, you're making an argument about transitions in which one must come with a focus on strategy, on constitution, and on history. Let's talk a little about that, because I think it'll help us understand your perspective on Machiavelli. How are these things related? How does conflict bring about a transition, for example, from the nation-state world of the 20th century to whatever is happening in our time?
I'll give you two examples. In 1494, Charles VIII comes across the Alps into the Italian plain, armed with lightweight cannon that are immensely destructive, but are also able to be moved from siege to siege and carried across the peninsula by oxen and horses. At a single stroke, the high stone curtains that protected the rich, weak cities of Italy, cities like Florence, Milan, Rome, Naples, Venice too, in a different way, more protected by a lagoon, become irrelevant. And these city-states, if they're going to survive, have to innovate constitutionally. They have to raise more revenue to tear down those walls and build smaller walls out from the city center on which to put their own artillery. They have to raise much larger armies because now they're confronting the armies from these other great countries whose populations are so much greater and who've mobilized such larger forces. They have to have permanent and stable diplomatic relations among themselves. When Machiavelli was serving as a diplomat, he would be an envoy, go to a court, but then come back. There were no permanent legations. These cities needed a more stable bureaucracy. They needed a government that didn't dissolve every 3 or 4 months as merchants returned back to their businesses and stopped governing. They needed a state. And Machiavelli appreciates this. And that's an example of how a change in the strategic context can bring about a constitutional change. But it would be a great mistake, and it was a mistake made in some cases by readers of The Shield of Achilles, to think that this is a sort of a single driver, a single arrow of causality. Skip ahead to the French Revolution. At the time of the Revolution, France had a highly professional army, typical of the territorial states of the 18th century. But the Revolution made that kind of an army, officered by an aristocracy, impossible. In its place, the French had millions of peasants and proletarians. They'd never carried a weapon. They'd never worn a uniform. They'd never marched. So Napoleon and his contemporaries had to fashion tactics and strategies that would serve that raw material, because that's what they had. Now, that's an example of a constitutional revolution, bringing about a revolution in military affairs. For the historian, it's really quite arbitrary. Where you step into the stream determines which part of the cycle you pick up. But separating strategy from law, I think, misses this historical dynamic, that you have to see how interpenetrated they are.
And you call law constitution, and that's really about the assignment of roles.
Yes.
in the society and its government.
Yes, in the Shield of Achilles, I make the argument that international law arises from constitutional law. This was the reverse of what many people said in the 20th century, Hans Kelsen most famously, but among many, that it's only when the state secures a monopoly of violence, as Max Weber and others wrote, within its borders, that it can then begin to assert its sovereignty against other states pressing on it. So I would say that international law arises from constitutional law, and that international law itself is a constitution of the society of states.
So talk a little more about the events of Machiavelli's time, in other words, because that's really a key source of his theorizing. So it was a struggle for power among the city-states, having to respond to intervention by outside actors.
And in the context of a complex set of competing families. In 1502, Machiavelli goes to Urbino, to the Ducal Palace, to meet Cesare Borgia. The night before, the Duke of Urbino had slept in that palace. That day, Borgia has seized the palace. He is dispatched by his father, Rodrigo Borgia, who is the Pope Alexander VI, to go forth from Rome with the papal armies and try and reconquer for the Pope each of these cities that form the papal states. It's Borgia's hope that he'll be able to found a principality around those states. And what Machiavelli wants to find out is whether or not he's also casting an eye on Florence. Is Florence safe? Can they buy off Borgia? Or will he keep his armies on the field and conquer Florence and bring it into this nascent principality? That doesn't happen. Borgia really is more interested in extortion than he is in conquest for as far as Florence goes. And the whole Borgia project eventually collapses after the death of Alexander VI. But Machiavelli has seen something. He's seen the possibility that the papal states, the states in the Romagna, these great cities, Bologna, can be allied with Florence itself. And he never forgets this possibility. He sees it once in 1502. He sees it again in 1513 and 1514 when Leo X is in Rome, a Medici Pope in Rome, and a Medici family in power in Florence. He glimpses it once more in 1522, and then it collapses. But that context and that hope never leaves him. And it is that ambition that drives these great works. And that's why, as I say, you have this otherwise puzzling end to the book that we know as The Prince.
And let's now talk about what you see in his theory and what his great contribution was in theorizing about how an old order was dying and a new one was emerging.
Machiavelli, writing in the context of feudalism, separates the person of the prince as an individual, from his role as a founder and sustainer of the state. And he says that whereas in feudalism, the Christian prince is always acting for himself, he is the embodiment the state. There is no state apart from himself and his line, and therefore must obey the classical virtues. that when a prince acts on behalf of the state, not on his own behalf, but on behalf of the public interest and the state, he may be compelled to do things that are in fact quite counter to the classical virtues. He may have to resort to violence, deceit. He may renege on his commitments, including his treaties. He may not be liberal in his dispersal of funds to the populace. He has to do those things that will further the public interest, even if they run counter to the classical virtues. And this was a thunderclap across Europe that was accustomed to writers saying that if you want to succeed as a prince, you have to behave in a way that accords primacy to the Christian classical virtues. Instead of looking to Machiavelli's state and the separation of the individual from the immortal state, something that Machiavelli thought we had to have to protect Italy and to protect Europe, his work was interpreted as just one more, although much more illicit and unattractive, version of an advice to a prince.
And we need to kind of grapple with this notion of somebody who's theorizing and getting into the mind set of the people running the previous world, but seeing the inadequacies of that, while at the same time anticipating the consciousness of a new way of thinking about the world.
That's a very interesting way of putting it, Harry. I hadn't thought of this kind of stereoscopic consciousness, but it accords with Machiavelli's success as a playwright. Someone who both is very able to observe behavior carefully and to take in a set of circumstances, but also to project drama, humor, satire, to superimpose his ideas on a situation. Yes, you're right.
You write at one point, Machiavelli, and I'm paraphrasing here, maintains that each political form, we're now getting into his the way he sees history, basically. And you write that he maintains that each political form derives elements present in its predecessor. So it's, and your argument in the shield of Achilles, is that the instruments and institutions that are developed in one era create their own contradictions in a way and give birth to a new world where the role of those institutions will be diminished or have to change drastically.
Yes. Machiavelli, from the time he was a young man, was obsessed with one great question. How is it that an individual can master or control his fate? On the one hand, he used this word virtu that is, I think, mistakenly absorbed into the false cognate virtue. It doesn't really stand for that. It stands more for manliness, resoluteness, courage, imagination, energy, more like the Latin word vir, which is a word for man. It's more like virtuosity, really, than virtue. And he asked himself, if we have a person of sufficient virtu, can that person triumph? Against this, he has another important idea, an idea very familiar to his contemporaries, indeed to classical thought, the notion of fortuna, this unpredictable force of nature that constantly changes our environment and throws up impossible problems for us. And he wants to know whether or not there can be a person of sufficient character to actually dominate fortune and to direct fate. Eventually, he decides that the answer is no. No. He observes that in European success stories, the rulers of very different characters succeed. Sometimes someone like Julius II, the warrior pope, is impetuous, warlike, aggressive, but someone like Ferdinand of Spain is more irresolute, more tentative, avoids warfare. That sometimes the successful party is consistent and firm, but then you have someone like the Emperor Maximilian who's constantly changing his mind, but he too is successful. What he concludes is that success is a matter of matching your character and its personality and drives with the needs of fortune. But because fortune changes and we cannot change our characters, if you live long enough, you'll fail. You will always fail. On the other hand, a republic can change its leaders. It can deploy a Winston Churchill when it wants a fierce, warlike leader, and then throw him out and put in a Clement Attlee when it wants a welfare state established. And by this means, he thinks, the virtue of a society, but not of an individual, can master, or is our best hope at mastering fortune. And that's getting to what you say about change, how success for a while will take a leader up to the heights. But each success, in my view, has within it the seeds of its own dissolution. Because we cannot serve all of our values simultaneously. And the very dominance of any particular form means that some values are being neglected, and they will eventually bring that order down.
Necessity is very important in this context, right? Because that is the driver of the situation, so to speak, that different characters are better suited to deal with.
Yes, Harvey Mansfield has a very nice formulation of this. He says something like, for political philosophers before, necessity was a context. For Machiavelli, it is a reason. It's, as you say, it's a driver. Because Machiavelli believes that the justification for power is serving the public interest, when a step becomes necessary to serve the public interest, it's mandated, it is required of the leader. If you're a pacifist and an enemy army is bearing down on your city, you have to take up arms, not because it's in accord with your values, but because it is necessary to protect the society.
You have a sentence which I have to paraphrase here, because it gets at the tragedy here of how one strategy might create a world which requires a new strategy because it's changed the structure. You say he recognized the cycling of policies and personalities as we struggle over time to preserve the values we have undermined and are forced to abandon the values that we have served.
Yes, that's an idea that actually goes back to a book called Tragic Choices. That was the first book I worked on with a marvelous man named Guido Calabresi, to whom this book is dedicated.
So let's understand this in the context of your analysis of the end of the Cold War and this emerging world of the 21st century. You talk about the decline of the nation state and the rise of the market state. Talk a little about that, the differences there, and how the strategy of one era spawned the contradictions that the next era had to deal with.
Well, for much of the 20th century, really beginning with the First World War, a constitutional order, the industrial nation state, struggled over one question. Would fascism communism or parliamentarianism be the legitimate form of that constitutional order. It animates the First World War, the Bolshevik Revolution, the Spanish Civil War, World War II, the Korean War, the war in Vietnam, the Cold War, are all about this question, and it is finally solved. It's finally ended in favor of parliamentarianism. And communism, fascism are historical relics now. That long war, an epical war like the Hundred Years' War, the 30 Years' War, an historian's war, a war that just appears to be won in retrospect, that war was won by the use of weapons of mass destruction, actually used in World War II, and then their deployment for deterrence in the Cold War. It was won by a global system of trade and finance, a relatively stable dollar, relatively open free trade, maintained by the United States and our allies, and a system of law. The interposition of international law on states, Nuremberg being an example. Those strategies and assets won that epical war for the parliamentary industrial nation state. And yet it had no sooner been won than the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, the sensitivity of our financial markets to global markets, currency flows, and the interposition of human rights law on states who hitherto had been sovereign in their own territories, until all of those elements began to undermine the nation state. A state that had been created to serve the nation, the ethnic cultural group, now was increasingly unable to do that. And I think you will see in the 21st century, I think you're already seeing the undermining of that constitutional order and elements of a new constitutional order, not so unlike the undermining in the 16th century of feudalism and the emergence of these first princely states.
How do you think Machiavelli, if he were living today, would view these changes? I mean, do you see him conceptually being able to grapple with the old consciousness and the new consciousness?
You know, I just don't think a person of the late 15th century, the early first quarter of the 16th century, could exist today. It's interesting to grapple with his ideas and to see if they have parallels today. But a person's consciousness, his values, his convictions are so much a matter of his peculiar day that I just can't imagine. I mean, one often hears someone say, well, you know, what would James Madison say about the national security agencies collecting metadata from telephone calls? I can't imagine a man who had never seen a telephone.
I guess I would play with is his kind of intellect could actually address these factors. I mean, in other words, his skill in getting into an old consciousness and seeing a new one. That's a very good point.
Yeah, he's a clever man, and he does, as he says in the letter that I read, commune with the ancients. But I think it would be false to project even a visionary like Machiavelli. You made the point, which I thought was an excellent point, that so much of Machiavelli's work comes out of his diplomatic work. And indeed, the dispatches and the white papers he wrote for the Signoria back in Florence formed the basis of much of the discourses, where he would just simply rewrite these passages, and a lot of the, what we know as the prints. So I don't think you can really tear a person out of that a context and be faithful to what he really thought. But you're right, he was a great visionary.
Talk a little about our present situation in the context of your theories. And you mentioned the NSA, the metadata, and so on, coming up against a constitutional concern defined over time of privacy and so on. How are leaders to make choices between these conflicting values, especially if they're on the threshold of a new era, basically?
Yes. Well, that very difficult question ended with the most difficult part of the problem. That is, the collection of all of this information by a government agency is just the beginning. The amounts of information that are being churned up that are in the hands of non-governmental organizations, corporations, global corporations, dwarfs anything that the NSA is doing. Indeed, the amounts of information in the hands of the government in our financial records that the IRS has, or medical records that Medicare and Medicaid and Social Security Administration have, are vastly greater, and access to them is vastly wider than anything that happens at NSA. And so, however we grapple with this, we're just at the beginning of an accelerating journey that I think is really unlike anything we've known. And will be increasingly a problem of a privatized world, a world that is privatized and globalized, and therefore is outside the grasp of national law.
And how then does an analyst distinguish between what is evolutionary and what is revolutionary in terms of transition to a new world order? Does the insight only come after the fact? Here I have in mind what's going on in Europe with regard to the European Union.
Yes.
I mean, how much of a revolutionary breakthrough, or is it not because it's just regional?
Well, I think that our intuitions and insights are not empirical in nature, if by that is meant that we accumulate data and sort it out and come to a conclusion about it. I think rather that we have these intuitions based, of course, in part on our experiences in government or in public life, but they're not captured simply by our experience. There's something more in the political philosopher like Machiavelli, who is speculating about a world that has never existed. Yes, it's partly his learning, you're quite right. Yes, it's partly his experience as a diplomat and government functionary, but the main part of it is a sort of inspiration. And whether that inspiration will be borne out by reality, as you suggest, we can only know in retrospect.
There's a point that you make in the book which I found very intriguing, which I do want to touch on, because part of building up a new consciousness and a new legitimacy for a new order is the work of history. I just noticed you said that in The Shield of Achilles. And Machiavelli...
I wish all my readers were so attentive, Harry.
That's part of the virtue of this program. I wind up reading things carefully. You point out that Machiavelli wrote a history of a gentleman named Castruccio Castracani in 1520. And you define Machiavelli as a historical rhetorician, basically. Talk a little about that, because you're saying, tell us what you're saying about the book, but yet it still was a step to building a new consciousness.
Machiavelli is often criticized by historians for being a not very good historian. And they take the examples that litter the discourses, and also appear in less number, perhaps because it's a much shorter book, in the prints, and they go back and look at the actual facts of the examples, and they say that they aren't borne out. And they say he's just a very careless historian who is ignorant of the facts, or perhaps twist the facts to serve his political judgments. I think this misses the point. Machiavelli is not trying to be an accurate historian or biographer. In fact, some of his examples are drawn from mythology. He's quite aware that he's not really relating what happened to Theseus and the founding of a Greek state. He has a long discussion of Moses, about whom there's very little historical material available to Renaissance writers. No, what he is doing is creating these sort of small narratives based upon his ideas about human nature. They're not so different from his work as a playwright. And sometimes the characters are mythological, sometimes they're historical. In the case of Castracani, it's a character in whom he puts things he cannot possibly have said and gives him a heroic deathbed speech that almost certainly never occurred and that is entirely plagiarized. It isn't because Machiavelli doesn't know better. It's because he's trying to make a political point through the use of a dramatic, memorable, and moving rhetoric.
So one final question. What is the lesson you would like to leave your readers with about Machiavelli and understanding him?
Oh, there's so many lessons, Harry. I mean, there are lessons on a human level. Machiavelli, at one point, says that fortune loves youth, and fortune will favor youth. But he also argues for experience and practicality, which are not characteristics of youth. And I've asked myself, what is it about a youth that he so much admires? Is it courage or indomitability? I've come to believe that it's hope, that the essence of youth is hope. And one lesson of Machiavelli's life, which faced so many cruel reverses, is don't give up hope. If things appear to be failing, change the set of circumstances. If you're exiled to your farm and you can't follow your life's work, start writing political philosophy. If the powers that be are not interested in your philosophy, get their attention with some salacious plays that will undermine the very structures they're using to oppress you. So the first thing I would say is don't give up. I think a second lesson is to read for ourselves. Machiavelli was misread early on and traduced by his early translators. And that kind of false depiction has taken on a life all its own. But if I gave the people in the studio who had not read Machiavelli, I gave them a copy of The Prince, none of them would say it was a mirror book. They would all say it was a constitutional text. And yet it takes some poor devil who's a constitutional law professor to notice this because we have so many centuries of misreading. I think maybe I'll leave it at this. I think maybe a final lesson is you're not serving the common good if you kid them or kid yourself. If you pretend there aren't trade-offs, if you pretend there aren't threats, if you pretend that it can all be made whole now and forever, you're not really serving the common interest.
Well, on that note, Philip, I want to thank you very much for being with us. It was quite a good discussion.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you very much for joining us for this conversation with history.